It is currently 7 o'clock, so I'm going to call this meeting to order, and it is now official. At this time, I'd like to request Pastor Dixon, if you could please do the invocation.
Can I ask you to pray with me?
Almighty God, we thank you so much for this day, for the opportunity to gather in this place tonight and to have conversations that many of us know hold extreme importance, not only in our own personal lives, but in the community that we live. We thank you so much for the men and women who serve on the front lines of protecting this community, for our officers and for those who serve behind the scenes and in ways that many of us can't even begin to fathom. Tonight, as we gather as citizens, as we gather as individuals who are hoping to learn how we can be better stewards of the community in which we live, we pray that you would be present in our conversation. We pray that you would guide and direct, and God, in areas where we don't understand, we pray for wisdom. In areas where we maybe even disagree, we pray that you would remind us that each and every one of us are created in your image. We thank you for Chief Capps. Thank you for the advisory board. Thank you for our officers. Thank you for our citizens. And we thank you for this time that we have together tonight. And I ask these things in Christ's name. Amen.
Okay. The next order of business is we would like to go ahead and have a motion for approval of the November 16th minutes. Okay, anyone second?
Second.
All in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Okay. At this time, I'm not showing any old business, so we will continue with tonight's forum. The advisory board, just for some background for all of you, was formed a little over a year ago at the suggestion of the Knightdale Police Department and with direct input from our elected officials. The Community Policing Advisory Board is a joint effort between the Knightdale Police Department, residents, business owners, and other community stakeholders in the town of Knightdale. Our purpose is to help forge and strengthen positive relationships and to be a communication tool for feedback, comments, suggestions, and questions. With the support of the town council, the board looks for ways to better engage the police department and the people of Knightdale in a collaborative effort to make this community a great place to live, work, and play. To that end, we have worked together over the last few months to plan and host tonight's community forum. I would like to take a moment to ask all of our board members to please stand and be recognized for your service in this unique endeavor. As you entered the chamber this evening, one of our board members provided you the opportunity to record your name for the purposes of participating in the open Q&A forum at the end of tonight. If you have not recorded your name but would later decide to ask a question, we ask that you please record your name, and that way we can follow up with any items that you may need. We also have, if needed, Spanish interpretation for any questions, as we do have a translator. And now, I'd like to introduce our MC, Jessica Day, that without further delay, as tonight's MC, and give her charge over the community forum. Jessica?
Good evening.
Good evening.
My name is Jessica Day, and I am the Vice Chair of the Police Advisory Board. I am so excited to be here this evening. I am originally from Knightdale. I was born and raised here in this area, so I have seen Knightdale grow from so much to where we are now, and I'm excited about where we are going to go, and I really want to be a part of that growth, which is why I am on this board. I went to UNCG and moved back here to Knightdale about 3 years ago, and now reside in Planner's Walk community. Recently, The Police Advisory Board and Knightdale Police Department asked for community input and feedback regarding the services provided by our local law enforcement. We wish to begin by sincerely thanking everyone who took the time to complete our survey and for the valuable feedback that you provided. It is important to know that residents, business owners, local leaders, and other stakeholders were surveyed in an effort to gain external perspectives on the policing priorities our law enforcement should focus on during the next 3 to 5 years. Tonight's forum is a coordinated effort to address your issues and questions and to provide the people of Knightdale an opportunity to hear from the board and their police department leaders on these important matters. The board and the police department would also like to thank our elected officials for their support and guidance over the last year. We would like to specifically recognize our mayor, Mayor James Robertson, and allow him the opportunity to address the audience.
Good evening. Thank you, Jessica. And thank you, members of our community, for your commitment to community. As we go throughout the year, the first thing I must say is, please, let's keep our first responders in our thoughts and prayers. They've been through a lot over the past few years, and we must do everything we can to be champions for them, because these folks lay their lives on the line for us every day. And I'm so appreciative of the hard work that these young men and women put forth for the betterment of our community. To our advisory committee, we cannot thank you enough for your efforts, your willingness to serve. This is what commitment to community is all about. And for those of you out there, our citizens, I would hope you would take this valuable information that you learned tonight, take it back to your communities, your neighbors, your friends, your family members, and get them involved. This is what community relations is all about. I thank you for being a part of this wonderful, wonderful forum. We look forward to working with you all throughout the year on many initiatives involving community relations. And on behalf of our town staff and our town council, we welcome you and we thank you. Thank you so much.
Thank you so much, Mayor Robertson. We're so excited to have you here this evening. Tonight's questions have been pre-formatted based on the responses and the feedback we received during our recent survey. Each question and certain follow-up questions will be presented to a designated panelist. All questions will appear on the overhead screen behind the panel here. Because the board values your time and your participation in tonight's forum, we will be adhering to defined time limits for responses to posed questions. Panelists will provide a maximum of 3 minutes to answer each question. Follow-up responses will be limited to 1 minute. Before we begin with our questions, I'd like to introduce tonight's panelists. First, Board Chair Holly Atkins. Ms. Atkins has the distinction of serving as the advisory board's first chairperson. Ms. Atkins is a resident of the Langston Ridge neighborhood in Knightdale and also runs Hope for Teens, a nonprofit organization focused on prevention of bullying. Next, we have board member Randall Owens. Mr. Owens is also an inaugural member of the board and one of two area clergymen serving on the board. He currently is the lead pastor at Cross Point Community Church. Our next board member is Nicole Torres. Ms. Torres currently serves as the board's teen representative. She is senior at Knightdale High School of Collaborative Design, a former graduate of the Citizens Police Academy and current police department intern. Next, we have Police Chief Lawrence Capps. Chief Capps is an 18-year veteran of corrections and law enforcement. He served with the Knightdale Police Department for 6 years and in the capacity of police chief for the last 2 years. Chief Capps is a graduate of Liberty University and the 257th session of the FBI National Academy. Next, we have Police Captain Jackie Boykin. Captain Boykin is a 20-year veteran of law enforcement. Captain Boykin oversees the agency's Support Services Division, a position she's held for the last 3 years. She is a graduate of NC State University and the 264th session of the FBI National Academy. And we have Council Representative Dustin Tripp. Councilor Tripp is serving in his second term to the Knightdale Town Council. Additionally, Mr. Tripp serves on the Council's Planning and Engineering Land Use Board Liaison Public Safety and Legislative Subcommittees. So now that we have the introductions out of the way, let's get started. Tonight's first question is for our board chair, Ms. Holly Atkins. As a resident of Knightdale and chair of the Police Advisory Board, how do you see the police department's leadership taking a proactive approach to creating an environment of trust between law enforcement and the community it serves?
Personally, I think the biggest effort I have seen is comprising this advisory board. I think that there has been complete transparency between our board and the leadership between Knightdale Police Department. I also have found that not only leadership, but all officers within the Knightdale Police Department have been extremely approachable and willing to help. And I think that is part of the whole trickle-down mentality of management. Lead by example is something that I have seen time and again within the police department. I have found that the leaders within the police department don't only think about themselves or the community of Knightdale, but they do express interest in the communities that surround us to assist not only Knightdale, but East Wake as a whole to become a safer community and forge those relationships. I have seen police officers help with filling gas cans for cars stranded on Knightdale Boulevard. I have seen impromptu visits to businesses just to make sure everyone's okay. How can they help? Being able to set time aside to just attend community watch meetings within subdivisions. That's actually how I started knowing a lot of the officers as well as Chief Capps. If Chief Capps could not attend a meeting, he would make sure someone was there for the community. So being able to attend those fall festivals for subdivisions, anytime there was a public safety event or even just a community event, making sure someone was out there and being approachable. And I have found that going forward, it will be a lot easier to approach them because in the past they have shown us how approachable they can be.
Thank you. Sure. Mr. Owens, same question. What is your take on efforts being made to create an environment of trust?
Holly stole all my answers. I was just going to take this. Yeah. I think, like you said, everything rises and falls on leadership. So when you see your police department looking for ways and taking the initiative to connect to our community, one of the things that I just recently was able to be involved in was the Citizens Academy, where you learn so much about your law enforcement. And I was able to watch other people of all ages, from high school students and adults from both genders, just wanting to understand how the police operates, and they are fully transparent. They go through their procedures, explain everything. So when you see the effort being put forth, you realize that it is not just coming from the top down, even though it does, it comes from the inside out. And so their job is made easier when they initiate and establish trust. I do love the idea of being able to be a part of this. I think everybody's time is limited in our lives, but the idea of being able to participate in this was worth our time. So just being able to be available and to help in some perspective has been a real asset. So I think I go back to our town is taking the lead on inviting the public into their lives.
Great, thank you. Our next question is for the board's teen representative, Ms. Nicole Torres. Nicole, the recent community survey indicated that there is a need for the police and young people to have more positive and meaningful interactions. As a local high school student and young adult, do you feel the agency has done a good job of creating opportunities for positive interactions? Also, what can young people in the community do to help create positive encounters?
Yes, and I say this from personal experience with the police department for the past 2 years. They have created so many opportunities, especially for me, being a Knightdale High School student. I have participated in the Citizens Police Academy and Public Safety Day, and the ride-along programs have created many opportunities for our teen community to be able to interact with our police officers. But I think we also have to understand that it can't only be one-sided. I mean, the police department can have as many programs as possible, but if our teen community doesn't make the effort to actually respond to these programs and participate in them, then it's always going to be one-sided. So.
Thank you. Thank you, Ms. Torres. Are there any panel members who would like to follow up on Ms. Torres' comment?
I actually would. Thank you. Nicole touched on something very important, and she's absolutely right. I was listening to the president's farewell speech a couple of nights ago, and one of the things that he did say that struck me and has stuck with me over the last couple of days was that the most important public office of all was that of citizen. And she is right in saying that it cannot be one-sided. The best government is that which governs least and governs at a local level, and that's what we're here about. And I think when you have one side of the equation taking the initiative and the effort to create community partnerships, when you have only one person or one side rather reaching out to extend that hand, it's not going to be as successful as it can be when both sides are creating opportunities to have meaningful interactions. And so I appreciate you actually saying that, and I would encourage you to maybe take a cue from Nicole and look for opportunities to come and engage us. We've got a lot of things to offer, and we're here to serve you. We want it to be a good relationship. Thank you.
Thank you. And now, Chief Capps. Many of the survey respondents asked about the department's demographic makeup as compared to that of the community. Can you comment on the issue of diversity within the police force and what measures the agency has taken or is taking to address it?
Thank you, Jessica, and I'd be happy to comment on that. I think it's important to know that this is going to be a big question moving forward. It's not only a question for us here in Knightdale. This is a question that my colleagues, the leadership and other police departments are asking themselves. I think it's a question that the leadership in a lot of municipal departments are asking about. You know, how do we have a workforce? How do we have people in local government that are representative of the communities and the populations that we serve. And it is a difficult task to say, here's the answer for dealing with the issue of diversity. What I can tell you is during the period of time that I have been here and during the period of time that I have been directly involved with recruitment and hiring of police officers for the town of Knightdale, we've seen a tremendous amount of change in our organization. I'm very proud to have women in my command staff, very proud to have women in leadership positions throughout my police department. We have some excellent minority officers in our organization as well. And we're always looking for opportunities to do more. And something that I think is very important is making sure now more than ever, as we're trying to reach out and find the best men and women to bring on board, that we're not necessarily looking to fill positions for the sole sake of diversity, but we're looking for a diverse group of people who rally around a common ideal, people who are willing to get behind a mission and a set of core values that are at the heart of everything that we do. And I think that if we focus on that, we'll find good people from all walks of life. Kudos to our Human Resources Department for helping us out when we advertise positions and making sure that those announcements and those job postings go to some of our traditionally minority colleges that are in the area. I have to give a huge thanks to members of my department for going and participating in a number of job fairs at a number of venues, again, engaging a diverse group of people and trying to attract folks to come and be a part of the great things that I think we're doing as a police department and all the good things that I hope we're able to continue to do as a police department.
Thank you. Captain Boykin, we understand that you work closely with Chief Capps to oversee the recruitment and hiring of new police officers. Can you offer any additional insight into the efforts made by our police department to address diversity?
Yeah, great, thank you. One of the things that we implemented back in 2014 was a recruitment plan. It's essentially a strategy for us moving forward to help us diversify our agency. It came to us through the accreditation process, and it helped us focus what the needs were for the agency in terms of creating that diversity. A couple of the items that we focus on are using our minority and female employees to target other minority and female applicants. We have found that this is somewhat beneficial. Over the last 5 years or so, we have improved the number of applicants that we have from the female and minority communities. But it's something that's not going to resolve itself overnight, and we have to continue working at it very, very hard. Another thing that we did as part of the recruitment plan was to create recruitment material that highlighted some of the community policing strategies that we focus on and highlight the employees that we have at the police department as well. I would like to comment real quickly too. I know I'll go over my 1 minute mark, but in response to the President's 21st Century Policing Report, the Department of Justice sent out a report here recently that gave some ideas for how police agencies could improve their recruitment pool and their applicant pool. And the three of the things that they recommended we're already doing, so it makes me feel good about the direction that the police department is going in terms of improving the minority and female representation within our applicant pool.
Great, thank you for that response. Just a little over, but that was an important comment. Along those same lines, Chief Capps, how do you ensure that only the best people are selected to serve as officers for the town of Knightdale?
This goes back to something that I just mentioned. It's about identifying people who are willing to adhere to a mission and a set of core values. And what we've found throughout our hiring processes is this. by the time these young men and women get to us, and in some cases, we have applicants who already have a lot of experience, a lot of work experience, a lot of life experience. Either way, when they get to us, that individual's character has already been shaped in a lot of ways. The individual that they are going to be, who they are at their core, their personal belief system has already been identified because of their exposures. And what we find is that people who have a personal belief system, a personal character, a personal life story that closely mirrors the core values that we emphasize as a police department, those folks do the best job. They serve this community the best. And so that's what we look for. We try to create a number of different opportunities throughout our selection and hiring process to tap into that, to identify, you know, who are you at your core? Are you an individual where you look at this job as a calling and not just a paycheck? Are you an individual that has a genuine care and concern for other people? Are you someone who has the ability to be an objective thinker? Are you empathetic? Are you the type of person that won't shy away from confrontation when confrontation is sometimes necessary? And how a person goes through life to form all of those characteristics and for all of those things to exist inside the same individual is extraordinary. Some of the things that we're asking our police officers to do today are things that we have never asked them to do before. The job is becoming more and more demanding, and you have to have an individual who's a peacemaker, a counselor, a mentor, a coach, a teacher, a leader, a community servant. And then sometimes you have to have that individual who's ready to go into that situation that a lot of us wouldn't go into ourselves, and, you know, things that are fraught from danger. And sometimes you have to be able to turn on a dime from the coach, teacher, leader mentality into that person that is immediately responding to, you know, a stressful and tense situation. How do you do that? How do you form those characteristics inside of the same person? And so really what we're looking for is people, as I said, whose life has shaped them in such a way that they already have core values that closely mirror our own. And that'll continue to be a focus moving forward. I told her before we got started that she would call me out on the on the time limits more than anybody else.
So. Thanks. Are there any panel members who would like to follow up on Chief's comments? Yes, Chair?
We'll get there. My minutes didn't start yet. I just want to follow up on that. There's a big thing that I believe in, and I think a lot of us do, and that's words, not deeds, not words. And I do have to say firsthand that when Chief Capps talks about character and possessing those traits of an officer, being that mentor, being that coach, he doesn't only do that in his work life. He is also a coach for the basketball team for the city of Knightdale. So he follows that into his personal life. It's just ingrained in him. And he's recruited some of the officers to co-coach, if you will. And they jokingly say that they were dragged in. But I just from a personal perspective, when Chief Capps talks about him and his officers having to mentor and having to ask extra of those officers, I pretty much call them dads in uniforms. Because there is no kid in Knightdale who would be scared to run up to a police officer, especially after they see them coach a bunch of 9-year-old boys on a basketball court. So I just want to say for the record that it's not just words that Chief Capps is saying, it's actually deeds that he does as well. So.
Great, thank you for that comment. Any other comments to follow? Councilor Dustin Tripp.
Thank you. Actually, I want to go back real quick and touch on the diversity issue, and I think this is very important. I think our police department really leads the pack for the town of Knightdale with this, and I know Mayor Robinson and myself have talked about this, But achieving diversity, and Chief Cap said this, it's not about numbers. It's not about how many of this type of person and this type of person you have in your department. It's about giving people the opportunity to get in the door where maybe the door wouldn't be open for them previously. So I think last council meeting, we actually swore in a new officer, and hopefully she doesn't mind, Carrie Campagna. Hope I said that right. So she had gone through the Citizens Police Academy. She was sponsored by Knightdale to go through Wake Tech's basic law enforcement training program. I mean, that's the town putting an investment into a person. And that's how you achieve diversity. You put that investment in those people and you bring them, you give them the skills that they need to be successful in the organization. So you get to see them from the start and then you get to see the payoff at the end. And I think that's very important. I really applaud our police department, especially Chief Capps and his officers for putting those efforts into people, because that's where you're going to make the difference at.
Thank you. Do we have any other comments? Thank you. Well, our next question actually is for you, our board liaison, Councilor Dustin Tripp. The recent community survey revealed that nearly 58% of respondents were curious about the measures police and town leaders were taking to address growth in Knightdale. Many expressed concerns about whether personnel and resources were expanding sufficiently to keep pace with the type of growth we are experiencing here in Knightdale. Can you comment on any conversations among local leaders about the need to plan ahead the expansion of emergency services?
Yes, ma'am. Thank you, Jessica. That's actually a really good question, and I think it's no secret that Knightdale is growing very rapidly. And one of our jobs as town council members is to make sure that we're trying to grow smart. I mean, Knightdale has an ETJ total of like 19 square miles. So we have a finite resource. So our land is very precious, and how we develop that land is very important. But you don't want to forget about the core services that you have to provide by expanding into those territories. So if you want to go back and look and say 2006, we had 17 sworn officers in our department, and we had a population approximately around 8,500, I'm guessing that number, because there's no real data from those years, so I had to take 2005 and 2010 and kind of split the difference there. So you're looking at about 500 residents per officer at that point. Flash forward to today, we're estimated at about 14,650. So we've gone up by about 72% residents here, and we have 29 officers. So we have about 505 residents per officer. So I think we're doing a good job at looking forward and knowing what's on the pipeline and getting those budgetary funds in place so we can hire more officers. This year alone, we hired 2 traffic unit officers because we saw a need there. We follow each year when we go through the budget process, we sit down with each department and they tell us our needs, and we're really responsive, or we try to be as responsive as possible to the department heads, and Chief Capps is really good about forecasting what he needs, and he lets us know and he shows us the numbers of this is what I need, this is what we're doing, this is our time of, it's how long it's taken us to get to a call, this is how many calls we're clearing. So all those things are very important. That's something we look out on a constant basis. If it's one thing we do, it's plan.
Thank you, Councilor Tripp. Chief Capps, can you offer any additional comments from your perspective on these conversations and the planning process?
I think to start by saying that I appreciate the voice that I am given and the opportunity that I am given to share the needs that we have within the police department. That is not something that exists everywhere, and so I don't take it for granted. I understand that as a department director, in a lot of ways, just like the elected officials, I am a steward of the tax dollars and resources that are coming in, and we need to be smart about how we spend taxpayer money. And as Councilor Tripp mentioned, it is no secret that we are growing. We are seeing, as I mentioned earlier, the demands that are placed on us and some of the things that we are being required to do on a day-to-day basis. It's growing. There's more work to do, and the work that we do is becoming more and more meticulous. We have committed to adhering to a set of professional standards that requires a commitment of resources. We are currently in the process of providing our elected officials, our finance committee, our council, with the information that they need to understand the needs that we have and the needs that we foresee having over the next 3 to 5 years in the way of personnel, facilities, equipment. And those have been real conversations. And as I said, I'm appreciative of the voice that they have given to me and confident and hope that I continue to do my part to share with them the information that they need to make the best decisions that they can regarding not just the growth for police department, but the growth for the town of Knightdale as a whole. I think you hit the nail on the head. It's about growing smart. It's about growing the right way.
Thank you. Thank you, gentlemen. Captain Boykin, our next question is for you. Many of our survey respondents believe that speeding, roadway congestion, and other traffic-related issues are among our biggest issues associated with the growth of our community. Can you tell us how the department is working to address traffic problems, and how is the agency adapting to the increase in traffic volume?
Thank you. For those of you who have lived here a long time, you know how different it is today compared to how it was 5 years ago or 10 years ago. I can remember driving through Knightdale when I was a college student at UCU going to the airport, and it was literally a crossroad that we came through. Certainly when the bypass was established, back in 09 or so, it made a huge difference in terms of the traffic that we see here in town, but really just on the Knightdale Boulevard kind of avenue. The DOT collects data every year, every 2 years, every 6 months, depending on the different kind of roadway. And on Smithfield Road alone, between 2005 and 2015, traffic increased from 3,200 cars a day on Smithfield Road to 7,900 cars a day, 8,000 cars a day coming through Smithfield Road. And it's not just that area. Every roadway in Knightdale is experiencing that growth. I think the most significant thing that we have done as a department to address it is to identify it as a concern for us. Annually, we put together goals and objectives for the police department that range from internal issues and dealing with manpower to the external issues and dealing with crime and traffic. And traffic has been one of the issues that we focus on annually every year. This helps us not just in responding to the day-to-day traffic crashes that might be out along the boulevard or along some of those other major roadways, but it keeps us focusing on the bigger picture. We're analyzing data daily, weekly, to see that we're deploying our resources where they need to be. The second thing I think that is critical in terms of our development and growth in that traffic arena is the dedication of a traffic unit. It's just in recent months, we've added two positions to the unit. They're not staffed right now. We're in the process of getting them staffed. But having people dedicated to dealing with the traffic issues that we have in town on a daily basis is critical. The traffic unit has four main priorities. The first is to address crashes. We dealt with 695 crashes last year, and a third of them were along Knightdale Boulevard. So obviously, we put a lot of our resources into the Knightdale Boulevard area to address those crashes. Our other priorities are addressing community complaints. We had 19 speeding complaints last year from citizens, and we spent almost 100 hours addressing those complaints and wrote almost 100 tickets and warnings for those sorts of things. So we value the input that we get from the community, and we hope to be working with them to respond to the needs that they have. The last two priorities are DWI enforcement and community outreach and education. It's a growing, they're both growing topics for us. Over 10,000 people die every year in DWI-related crashes, and we don't want it happening in Knightdale. So we do put forth a good bit of effort towards the enforcement against DWIs. And we have officers who are giving presentations and seminars in the high school setting to establish some good foundation for kids as they're getting into driving, you know, early on. So we hope that that's making a difference. And as I said, it's a growing unit. So I think our responsibilities within the traffic unit will be expanding in the coming years.
Thank you. Are there any other panelists who would like to comment?
I used up all the time.
All right. Then we are going to go back to Mr. Owens for the next question. In the recent survey, citizens identified the following policing issues as those the department leadership should focus on most over the next 3 to 5 years. Traffic enforcement, increase of manpower, resources, and facilities, emphasizing proper police culture and core values, community policing strategies, strong SRO presence in schools, and better training for our officers. As a citizen, local community leader, and a family member of a law enforcement officer, do you feel these focus issues are the priority? Why or why not?
I was looking over the list and have been. I really do feel like that's a fair representation of what most of us in the community, I mean, we don't live from the inside of law enforcement. We live sort of on the outside and get to enjoy what happens as a result of living in a community that is protected and is served by law enforcement. So I think that's a great synopsis of the things that would help. I think overall beyond that, again, having a family member in law enforcement in another nearby local town, is the one thing that you see, and I see in culture altogether, is oftentimes just the overall feeling of if we would learn to respect each other and respect authority. I remember a long time ago when I was a kid being pulled over by a police officer who was not real respectful of me, and my mother reminded him that he was not respectful of me. And but she also taught me, and not by example that day, but she taught me the point of being respectful for authority, that laws are there to adhere. And so I feel like if all of these individual things were sort of under the umbrella of when there are traffic enforcements, when a law officer approaches you and they treat you with respect regardless of your ethnicity or gender, you have learned from your parents or from family structure to be, all of these go back to, I feel like a lot of these go back to just a community respect for each other and the idea that the law enforcement is here to protect and serve us, and we're to respect their responsibility to do so, even when we're out of line. So I love the umbrella. I do think this, what the community has represented, and I think that is a great breadth in representing those different areas, and they're probably a little bit, you know, there are probably a few more that could be added to that, but I love the idea that I think we live in a community where the officers, when they do have to enforce law, they come in understanding that they serve the public that they're encountering, and I've had nothing but respect from them, and I think that returns in kind that response of respect for them. And I probably don't say it enough because I try to avoid the police, but they deserve the respect by their position first and foremost, but I think they earn it. They earn it by the way that they treat us and the way that they are honestly proactive in putting together a panel such as this and the events that they do. So I love the idea of community and respect for each other.
Thank you. This follow-up question is for any board representative. What other issues that are not listed here do you feel will be important to focus on in the coming years? Is there any that would like to respond? If not, we will move to the next question. Captain Boykin, this next question is for you. The term community policing is mentioned countless times in the recent survey responses. For those who are not familiar with the term, tell us what community policing is and explain how it is used by the Knightdale Police Department.
Community policing is a philosophy where the police department is building relationships with different organizations, people, groups within the community to work together to address and solve problems within the community. I think about traditional policing as, you're just trying to address the crime. You respond to the 911 call, go take care of business and leave. And community policing is more digging into what's going on. What is causing this crime to happen? It requires that you do some surveying of what's going on. It requires you to do some analysis and assessment on the type of response that you have. It requires you to be proactive in your response and not wait for that 911 call to come in. It goes beyond looking at the numbers of crime and deal with the feelings of safety and security that people have. I could argue all day long that Knightdale has an exceptionally low crime rate. We're in the top third for safest communities in North Carolina. But if you live in a neighborhood that is experiencing bicycle theft or break-ins, you don't feel safe, and we have a responsibility to you as a citizen or you as a business owner to work together and address those problems. In Knightdale, we assign our officers to zones within the town, and they are responsible for different neighborhoods within those zones. Ideally, our officers should be meeting the people who live in those different neighborhoods. I want you to know our officers' first names, and I want you to have their cell phone numbers. And if you have an issue or a concern, you feel very comfortable calling them because you've developed that type of relationship where you can give them a call, even if it is on their day off. We ingrain the philosophy of community policing in our officers from day one. First of all, this is not anything new. It came about in the 1980s or so, so police departments have been doing it for a long time. It's a very basic part of the police academy, so they're learning about it early on. But during the field training process, our officers have to identify an issue within a community and address it when they've only been here for 3 months. So we're really encouraging and cultivating that problem-solving philosophy. It's included in our evaluations. We focus on community policing strategies through our department plan and through our strategic plan. So it's something that I feel is institutionalized within the Knightdale Police Department, and we're working to better develop the relationships in the community. I feel like it's been successful, and it will only continue to grow.
Thank you. Chief Capps, are there any follow-up comments that you would like to offer regarding the department's community policing efforts?
Absolutely. I think community policing as a whole goes back to something that we've already touched on. It can't be a one-way street. If you expect the police to solve all the problems, to be aware of all of the issues that are going on in the town of Knightdale, that's probably not a realistic expectation. There are 32 of us. There are over 14,000 of you. The more people that we can meet and cultivate relationships with, the better off we will be in the end. Community policing is much more than a philosophy. It's much more than a strategy. It is actually a verb. You have to get out there and you have to actually do it. It involves an investment of time. As Captain Boykin said, it requires getting out and understanding, you know, what's going on this street, what's going on in this neighborhood, what are the problems and issues that are important to you, and what might be causing those problems, how can we help, and what information might you be able to give to us that would put us in the right direction, because we may think we know the answer, and we're good at solving a lot of problems. But as I often tell people, you know your street, you know your community much better than I do. I don't necessarily live there. You do. So help me understand your community so that I know exactly what we can do. And in the same breath, I'll tell people, what are you doing? How are you taking an active, you know, approach to deal with this? And I'll end here in just a second, but I've got to share this. I had a captain that I worked for previously in my younger days, and he was of the opinion that the police car and the police radio were the worst things to happen to law enforcement in terms of disengaging people. I don't necessarily agree with him on the point that he was trying to make, but I understand what he was trying to say. In that it has to be much more than waiting for something to happen. We enjoy a quality of life and a level of crime here in Knightdale that other municipalities, cities envy. They envy it. And if we want to keep it that way, it's going to require an investment in community policing, involving the community, involving the police, and identifying the issues that help keep that quality of life high and that level of crime low.
All right. Thank you. That was good insight in how we connect with the community. We are coming back to you, Ms. Atkins, for our next question. Several of our survey respondents asked how they could better support the local police department or become more involved with the department to better address problems, concerns within their neighborhoods. What advice or direction can you give to other residents on how to build good relationships with the Knightdale Police Department?
I think my primary suggestion would be to invite them. Invite them to your subdivision events. Invite them to your gatherings. Invite them if you're a business owner. Invite them in on safety measures for your particular organization, whether it be a storefront or a meeting place. I would also suggest that you take them up on the Citizens Police Academy. It's a lot of fun. It's only once a week for 8 weeks. You learn so much in regards to our police department and the time and effort that not only Chief Capps but the other officers put into it is astounding. I would also recommend that if you're looking for them to be approachable, you need to be approachable. If you see them out on the street or you see them in Lowe's Foods just walking around the aisles, say hello to them. Don't ignore them. That being insular isn't going to make yourself approachable. So I would recommend that as an individual or as a business, invite them in on a very positive level, and what you'll get back is some rewarding dialogue and exchange on a positive level.
Great.
I'll make a shameless pitch for the Citizens Academy. We're going to open the academy here within the next 2 months or so. We anticipate it starting at the end of February and going for about 8 weeks. I'd encourage you to like our Facebook page and look for the advertisements for it there, and we would love to get 20 citizens or so who'd be interested in coming to learn more about us.
Great, thank you. Time goes by fast. It seems like we just had last year, but it is great. Mr. Owens, Ms. Torres, Councilor Tripp, would you have any comments that you would like to add?
I think what we've kind of touched on here, and this is something I was a student in public administration, so I've pretty much gone through a lot of these things. But if you've ever heard of the broken window theory, if you allow a window to be broken and stay broken, eventually the neighborhood will degrade down. So keep that in mind. When you're in your neighborhood and you see things, it's we're all in this together. We're all members of the community together. If you see something, say something. Don't hesitate to call the police department. They're looking to come help you. That's what they're here for. If you have a speeding problem or you notice somebody suspicious, they don't mind you calling them and them coming out. Get to know your neighbors. I can't tell you how many people don't know their neighbors, and that's, to me, that's astounding. I know pretty much everybody on my street, and especially my block. And it takes time. You have to build those relationships. But we've held community events just like some of the other neighborhoods, and we've had good representation from the Knightdale Police Department and the Fire Department have came out. They spent a lot of time with us, let me beat them in cornhole, and enjoyed some food with us. But it's really about the fellowship, getting to know them, and getting to know the residents, the other residents of your neighborhood. Planner's Walk is one of the greatest neighborhood watches. You know, they're the longest running neighborhood watch in Knightdale, and they're one of the models that we've looked at. If you're looking to start one up, contact the police department. They'll be glad to help you. Representatives from Planner's Walk, I'm sure, would be glad to assist you with that. But it's really about taking ownership and making sure those broken windows get fixed.
Great. Thank you. Ms. Torres or Mr. Owens, do you have any comments to add? Okay. Well, our final question for the evening goes to Chief Capps. One of the most interesting responses we saw in the recent survey had to do with a policing strategy. Nearly 15% of residents indicated they favored a return to traditional responsive policing. Can you clarify what that is? And do you agree or disagree with this type of approach to policing?
Absolutely. And we've touched on this already. You know, traditional responsive policing is being in a position where you are responding to calls. People are going to call 911. We don't yet live in a society that is free of problems, free of crime. The police are a societal necessity. And usually when people reach out to us, it's because something has happened, and they need us to come and to help them resolve an issue. They need us to come and protect them in some instances, investigate a crime that they're reporting. It could be a number of different things. And so, you know, traditional responsive policing has to do with waiting to hear from the people that need you, rather than engaging those people ahead of time so that in a moment of crisis, they know what to do for themselves. They know the best way to reach out to the police department for the services that they're looking for. You know, I often share with people that if you wait for a moment of crisis to forge relationships, you failed already. And I think there have been a number of examples that we have seen over the last couple of years where, you know, it wasn't necessarily the issue that played out that was the real problem between the community and the police. It was the lack of investment in building the proper trust and partnership ahead of a crisis event that ended up being the most significant. And so I think for us, you know, policing and strategy that involves simply responding to calls, waiting for an issue to occur, that can't be the approach that we take. If we think that is going to be the solution for us here in Knightdale, then we may as well commit to the fact that the quality of life is going to diminish and that the level of crime will increase. Community policing involves the community and the police, and it involves engagement, not simply waiting for something to happen. We'll be there when those things happen. We'll come running. We'll bring a lot of help and a lot of resources with us. But to keep those types of situations from happening frequently, let's make an investment on the front end by not waiting for things to happen.
Thank you. Before we conclude, panelists, is there anyone who would like to provide any additional comments? All right, if not. Thank you so much for your thoughts and for your responses to these questions. This was an excellent way to continue meaningful conversations regarding the future of our police department and its relation to our community. Audience, As you've listened to the panelists' responses, perhaps now you may have a question that you would like to ask. It may be something related to a topic already discussed, or something different that also deals with the police and community relations in Knightdale. So we're going to open the floor for about 20 minutes to give you an opportunity to engage our panelists here. Before we do that, I'd like to remind everyone who poses a question to be sure your name is recorded on the ledger on the table to the right. And we have those on the table there. This information is necessary to keep accurate minutes for our meeting this evening. Chief Capps and Board may also wish to reach out to you on a personal level regarding your questions. If you would like to pose a question to a member of the panel, there are a few things also to remember. The board will give priority to those individuals whose names were recorded prior to the start of tonight's forum. Again, you can still pose a question even if you have not yet registered your name. Simply just raise your hand and wait to be recognized. Those with questions will be asked to use the microphone. Your questions are very important to us, and we want to answer as many as possible in the allotted time. So please pose your questions as succinctly as possible, and be sure to indicate which of our panelists you would like to answer your question. We would like to remind everyone that we are still engaged in a formal advisory board session. Differing opinions, objective conversation, and healthy debate are often necessary in order to address and resolve important issues. We do ask, however, that a mutual level of respect is maintained. So, with that being said, we will now open our question and answer session. And we will start by recognizing Mr. Keith Gibbs. Yes, sir. Do we have the microphone? We do ask that you speak into the microphone.
Thanks, Raymond. Chief Capps, how many Knightdale police officers and staff live within the community of Knightdale itself, just by percentage? That's a curiosity question.
Absolutely. This is a question that we've actually fielded before, and roughly 25% of our officers live directly within the town limits. We have a number of officers who live within a very short commuting distance, some coming from the Archer Lodge area, some coming from the Clayton area. We also have a number of other officers that live right here in Wake County. And so we have a lot of officers that, again, live in close proximity, several officers that live here in town as well. There's always a question about is there a certain or an ideal percentage that an agency should be looking for in terms of, you know, the number of officers that live within the jurisdictions that they serve. And as you can imagine, in some municipalities, in some communities, in some jurisdictions, officers are probably looking for the opportunity to be as far away from it as they possibly can. Fortunately for us, as I said, we've got a quality of life and we have a level of crime that makes it an attractive place to live for some of our folks. And I think that will continue to be the case moving forward. A lot of our folks do come to the department with, you know, residences and lives established in other places, difficult to move and transition sometimes. But the great thing about it is that we have a lot of officers who, if they don't live in the community, are invested in the community. Coming back, getting engaged in events like this, coming back on their days off to participate in block parties in some of our subdivisions. And so I think, you know, one of the important things that I would emphasize is that, you know, we have a lot of officers that even though they don't live here, they are as invested in this place as if it were their home.
Thank you. I have Absolutely. Two small follow-up questions if nobody else has one. Okay. Okay, the second, what unique policing challenges do exist within Knightdale? I understand we have a great, very low crime rate and stuff, but I'm curious
about that.
Sure. I think the folks who responded to the survey are as attuned to the issues and the challenges that we're going to be facing in the future as we are. I think traffic enforcement, traffic education is going to continue to be an issue for us. If you think about where Knightdale is positioned and you think about how many people are coming into Knightdale or through Knightdale to get to other areas, and then you think about the number of connector roads that actually service this area, there aren't that many. Captain Boykin gave a very poignant statistic earlier about just the increase on Smithfield Road in a period of time. That's one of those connector roads. Traffic's going to be an issue for us. Learning how to keep pace with the growth that is taking place in the community is very important. There are several members in the police department who are currently engaged in the development of a strategic plan. What we're doing internally is identifying the issues and trying to prioritize for ourselves what we need to focus on in year one of this strategic plan, year two of the strategic plan, year three of the strategic plan. And a lot of that involves much larger conversations with not only our advisory board, but our public safety committee and our town council, or other town leaders as well, to say, you know, here's what we recognize as a potential need, a potential challenge. You know, let's talk about the financial impact that's going to have, and let's talk about what we need to do to look at growing our police department. Those conversations are being had. I think growth for us is something that we're focusing on pretty intently right now. And while there aren't issues or problems that we deal with frequently or on a day-to-day basis, we do recognize that we're uniquely positioned because we're in Wake County. We're going to see some things, and we're going to eventually encounter some things that are going to require resources, manpower, things that we don't currently have. A big part of that is making sure that we provide information related to our employment forecast, information related to facility needs, issues related to police training. As I said, our officers are being asked to do things today that they weren't being asked to do 20 or 30 years ago. And so we have to be able to make sure that they have the training, they have the resources and the tools to meet your expectations in terms of service. And what we believe is that you have high expectations. We want to meet those expectations. And in order to meet those expectations, we have to make sure that we have the ability to do so through training, through resources. That's a great question to ask. It's something we're focusing on. It's a part of a much larger conversation that I think I'm safe in saying is currently being had at a very high level within our town.
I was just getting started. So
now we have Ms. Winifred Richardson.
Good evening. This is for Chief Capps. I'm with the HOA at Emerald Point, and we've had the 15 mile an hour speed limit signs up for approximately, I would think, close to a year, maybe a little less. At this stage, they wanted me to find out, where do we go from here to see if we can get the actual speed humps or bumps, whatever. They gave me a certain terminology, but you understand what I'm trying to convey.
Sure.
So I just wanted to know what we need to do from this point. And we have a meeting Saturday, and I wanted to bring them back an answer on what we can do.
Sure, absolutely.
And thank you for your having this community. This community information is great.
Absolutely. Thank you very much. We really appreciate the relationship that we have with the folks in Emerald Point. And you're right. Traffic in Emerald Point, speeding in Emerald Point, has been something that we've actually put a lot of effort and man hours into over the last couple of years, I know of specifically. I will give you the answer that I would give any other citizen from any other neighborhood asking the same question. You know, we currently have a traffic calming policy for the town of Knightdale. There are very specific steps that we try to follow before we get to the place where we have to actually make engineering changes
to reduce speed. And so one of the first things that we do is try to go out and, you know, monitor the situation ourselves. We work very closely with our development services division to actually put devices in place that will capture the total number of vehicles that are going through our area, give us feedback on exactly what the true speeds are. And once that process is established, if we identify that there is in fact a speeding issue, obviously enforcement is the next step. You know, and is it blind enforcement, or is it enforcement where we want to try to identify who your offenders are? And I think about you know, Emerald Point specifically. You know, there's pretty much one way in and one way out. Folks that are going into that community either live there, they may be visiting there, or they have some other legitimate business in that community. What we oftentimes find is that when we engage in our enforcement practices in those neighborhoods, we end up catching you know, individuals who live in that community in the act of speeding. The individuals who have the most interest in adhering to the speed limits are, you know, often the folks that are you know, sometimes contributing to the problem. One of the things that we did in Emerald Point as well was we had a pretty robust public safety education campaign. We actually went into the neighborhood, we knocked on every single door, and we gave them information about the traffic statistics that we had discovered, the enforcement actions that we had taken, and what we were going to be doing moving forward. There was a lot of behind the scenes things that you guys were doing in terms of passing the petition, getting signatures, and really pushing and promoting the speed limit reduction. And so that went into play. And suffice it to say, the installation of a speed limit sign is much, much less expensive than the installation of a series of speed cushions. And so if you feel that you're at that place again where the installation of speed cushions or some other sort of engineering changes may be necessary in order to bring about the reduction in speed, it goes back into a conversation between you know, your representatives in your community, the police department, and our development services department to actually, all right, let's go back out there. We need to look at it again. It's a constant process of evaluation, coming up with a plan, carrying out that plan, and now let's see what worked. Let's see what we need to do, you know, moving forward. And I'm happy to, you know, defer to Councilor Tripp. I know he's been involved in some of these conversations before. But you're welcome, sir, to add anything to that if you'd like. Thank you for that question.
Thank you, Chief. I think Chief Capps actually covered it pretty well. At this point, we did reduce the speed limits in Emerald Point neighborhood. So if that's not working, Chief Capps is correct. We need to make contact with the Development Services Group and let them get the stealth stat devices out there to log the speeds again and make sure we're hitting that window to meet the policy. And then there's some steps in the policy. So if you have your representatives, contact Chris Hills, who is our development services director. He can help get you through that process, and we can get that set up and take a look at it. And we'll take a look at that in committee as well. So I'll recommend that on the planning engineering committee. But first and foremost, get your HOA representatives to definitely contact Chris Hills and go ahead and start that process so we get that ball rolling. All right, thank you.
All right, thank you. Do we have any other questions? I will come back to Mr. Gibbs. I know you have a few more.
First, Councilor Tripp, and you don't need to get back up. You used an acronym earlier, and he said something about
what does that mean? Extraterritorial jurisdiction. So that means not actually in the town limits, but in our planning district.
And you said it was 19 something?
It's about 19 square miles. It's like 19.2, something close to that.
Captain Boykin, you discussed bike theft just as a hot button issue, and I see this a lot in the forum and in our community. Is there anything to do about that? I know when I was little, or shorter and younger, this big, we had to do this bike rodeo, and the police actually etched my name and a registry number onto my bike in a town where it would never be stolen anyways, and you know, my basketball coach was our captain of police. But regardless, I'm just kind of curious to take that back to some people.
I would say first and foremost, folks need to take some responsibility for their things that they have at their home. Not a great idea leaving your bicycle in the front yard. It's just reality that those sorts of things aren't as safe as it was when we were much littler in every way. I would encourage folks to record serial numbers. If your bicycle doesn't have a serial number, to etch one in, just like you said, and keep that information recorded. One thing that I think is beneficial in terms of the development of technology is our ability to get information out. And so every, I don't know, month or so, you'll see pictures or posts about bicycles that have been turned into the police department. And we've had a small bit of success in terms of pairing them back up with the proper owner. We need to have those bicycles reported when they are stolen. I'm a member of a couple of different community groups online through social media, and I see a lot of people talking about their bicycles being stolen, but it was never relayed to us, so we can't help you out if we don't know about it. So just taking a couple of steps on your own end and then giving us some feedback and assistance in trying to find the bicycles when time comes for us to be looking for them. When you see a 15-year-old male riding a little pink bike through town, give us a call because it's probably not his. And that's the suspicious activity that we're interested in going and looking into later.
Awesome. Thank you.
Thank you. And we will entertain one further question unless we have any other questions from, if anyone else has thought of a question they would like to ask. Just raise your hand. No? All right. Did you have one more? We'll have
one
final question.
Were there any charges brought or official warnings given to anyone for soliciting within the town of Nightdale? You know, door to door, which I understand must be permitted by the town. You must apply for a permit and stuff. So basically anybody that knocks on your door isn't supposed to be there, unless they're like UPS or something. I know that's a big issue in our neighborhood, and it's asked about a lot, Princeton Manor. So,
thank you for that question. We do get some calls from time to time about solicitation in neighborhoods. The ordinance related to solicitation did recently undergo a revision. People do now have to fill out an application. If they're applying for this permit, there is a vetting process that the police department actually puts these individuals through. The last thing I want to do is send someone into your community that has a history of breaking and entering, for example. And then we work closely with our administrative services division to actually issue permits and then communicate to our officers. And we try to communicate into the neighborhoods as well when those permits have been issued, who they've been issued to. And that way, when you see someone there, you kind of have an idea of who they are. To my knowledge, we have not issued any citations to anyone for solicitation. One of the things that we try to do when we can is with issues like that, particularly ordinances, when a potential violation is brought to our attention, what can we do to resolve it without official enforcement action? Is this simply an issue of education, or is the person not aware of the process? Is it a situation where a warning may suffice in lieu of a citation? And we leave that to the discretion of the good men and women that are actually out there on the roads responding to those types of calls. So there's no specific mandate that you have to issue a citation. One of the greatest powers that we have as law enforcement officers is the ability to apply discretion. And I think discretion applied appropriately is the best way again to cultivate a great relationship between the people that we come in contact with, whether they're necessarily doing something wrong or whether we're just simply trying to build a better partnership with someone in the community. So again, I really leave it in the charge of the men and women that are out there responding to those calls to go there, gather the facts, be objective, and then come up with a decision that you believe as the investigating officer is the most appropriate course of action. Here's what I'll also say before I sit down. If you have those instances in your neighborhood, please, please, please call us. I've said this many times before. I would rather come and spend 10 or 15 minutes to discover that there's not a problem than to respond 3 or 4 days later and discover that there was a significant problem that could have been prevented. So you're not bothering us. You know, and we hear that from time to time. I know you folks have got more important things to do. I just feel like we're wasting your time. No, this is what we're here for. Call us. Let us come. Let us make a determination. You never know, and it has happened before. You may be the person bringing something very minor to our attention that later turns out being the key to averting something much more significant. So please call. That's why we're here.
Could you define that for, like, soliciting? And is that a salesperson selling stuff in your neighborhood? Is that a church handing out invitations? Is that
what I'd actually like to do is provide you with some information in the interest of time that will take you directly to the ordinance, and it explains that process, what the individual has to go through, and then also to you as well as to exactly what is covered under our ordinance in terms of solicitation. Is that fair enough?
I have it. You don't have to go other way.
Good enough. I'll make sure that you have it then, Mr. Owens. Thank you.
Is that an open invitation?
Well, thank you. And thank you for the question. Are there any closing remarks from our panelists?
I just want to end by saying thank you very much again for your time. I've said this to people a lot before. The gift of time is the one thing that when you give it away, you can never give it back. So how you spend it is pretty important. And the fact that you gave a little of your time to us this evening, it means a lot. And if we could be of service, please call on us. That's why we're here. I hope this is the first of many forums that we're able to engage in, and I hope that in the future we'll see you folks back, see your neighbors and your friends and your family back. We won't shy away from tough questions, so if one of those comes up in the future as well, it's our responsibility to answer to those as well. So thank you very much, and again, it's been a pleasure to have a few minutes with you to address some of the issues and concerns that are most important to the people that we're serving here in Knightdale.
Thank you. Any other panelists' comments? Final remarks?
One quick one. I'll be quick. I want to give you another acronym, Mr. Gibbs. ARC. ARC. So that stands for Accountability, Respect, and Customer Service. That's Town of Knightdale's core values. I think this forum definitely, in this body of the Community Policing Advisory Board, is definitely looking at the core values of accountability and respect, but overall customer service. And that's a big key. That's something that we're pushing really hard, is the customer service aspect of all of the Town Knightdale employees and staff. And I think Knightdale Police Department is doing a great job and leading by example of really following through on that customer service piece. And I think that's what community policing is all about. It's about good customer service. So like everybody else, thank you very much for coming out tonight. I really appreciate seeing such a good audience, and I hope the people watching are equally as informed as everybody was here, and we really appreciate everybody's time and consideration.
Thank you. Any others? No? Okay. As stated, yes, thank you, audience, for coming this evening. It means a lot to have you come out and be a part of it. Thank you for your questions. Thank you for being engaged. Thank you so much, panelists, for being here as well, for being able to answer these questions. I believe this has been a great evening, and we do hope that this is the first of many, as Chief Capps has stated. Your questions are very important to us, so if you did not get your questions answered, if you still have questions, please feel free to ask those questions. You can send those questions to, if you go to www.nightdalenc.gov, and then go to Town Council and Citizen Boards, look for Police Advisory Board. You will find the contact information for the Police Advisory Board, and you can send your questions there if you have any additional after this evening. So again, we want to say thank you so much for being a part of this. And for me, it has been an honor to serve you as your MC tonight. And I would like to recognize Chair Atkins for our adjournment. Motion for adjournment.
Okay, second?
Second.
Okay, all in favor?
Aye.
Any opposed?